Thank you and hello everyone. As West Bengal gears up for a major assembly poll, we would be discussing in this session a hotly debated topic. Growth versus populism, the West Bengal model. To discuss this, we have an eminent economist turned politician, Dr. Amit Mitra, the veteran finance minister of West Bengal. Welcome, Dr. Mitra, to the India Today East conclave.
Thank you very much.
Dr. Mitra, if you look at the current West Bengal model, and if you look at the kind of populistic schemes that have been set up, you have it right from birth to adolescence, to marriage, to education, to work, and right up to death. Okay, there's this whole gamut of schemes that is there, and it seems that the Bengal model is being dominated by populism and populistic schemes versus economic growth. That in some senses, economic growth is suffering because of these kind of doles that are going out. What is your point of view on that?
I think, first of all, this growth versus populism is a misnomer. It's a myth. In the 19th century, this word populism was discovered, where it was meant to be people versus the elite. Now, in that case, I'm with the people, so is Mamata Banerjee. In fact, Ernesto Loclau, one of the political scientists very well known, says, populism is emancipatory social force through which marginalized groups challenge the dominant power structure. That's precisely what Mamata Banerjee has done. So, and two, I will show you in a moment that so-called populism in this context of empowerment in fact leads to growth.
Okay.
So they are not only not you must know that you would probably know in 2019, if you take nominal growth rate of states and India, West Bengal grew at over 12%, which was number one in the country.
Though now, somewhat disputed.
Is it that, yes, why is it that at every parameter you take, you'll find West Bengal is well ahead of India? Why is that so? Because there is an connection between the schemes that we take and GDP growth. For example, capital expenditure, West Bengal has grown up by 11 times since we came to office. That produces the Keynesian multiplier. All that is not talked about. I come to populism and I would like to defend it. I would like to go straight to, for example, the Narodniks of Russia were called populists. The People's Party in USA were called populists. Let me go straight to a story that will be, it'll explain what you're saying right away. A young girl called Moushumi Mirza, from where? From Sundarban, the Royal Bengal Tiger. Her father died when she was very. Her uncle brought her up, Mama, went to school in the local school nearby. Then she came to a stop, which she couldn't do anymore. School uplinked digitally her details when she became 18 years of age. And you know what happened? 25,000 rupees came into her bank digitally, for which the highest award in the world has been received by Mamata Banerjee's West Bengal, called the Kanyashree. Now, you know what happened to that girl? She went to college, got an honors degree because of the 25,000 and 1,000 rupees additional, populist. And he graduated from Sundarban Hazi Desharat College in Pathankari. So that girl has created human capital, which will then translate into growth into the future. Now, the second, I would like to...
Dr. Mitra, can we come to the second example? I'm sure as we talk, you'd like to give the second example as well. But yeah. I'd just like to interject at this point.
Yes, please do.
That while you say that populism and populistic leads to growth, somehow this seems to have a duality in it. When it comes to central government schemes, like
yes.
the one for Kisans, which was giving
yes.
rupees 6,000 a year for them, which the
yeah.
central government had initiated in February 2019, the Modi
right.
government accuses the Mamata government of non-implementation of these schemes. Now,
yes.
What is the explanation for that? On one side, you say we welcome it, but when it comes from the central government, because it is the Modi government there, you all don't, you know, welcome it at all.
No, I just before going on to this scheme,
right,
on the central government issue, Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao was a big project of the central government, right? Clap, clap. Now, by that time, our Kanyashri has already come into place. Do you know how much it has spent? We have spent 9,000 crores on the Kanyashri program. All of India, central government has spent 523 crores. And what is most dangerous is 78.91%, almost 80% of the money has gone into advertising. Advertising whose face? So you allocate 500 an entire sum, 80%, you just do advertising. Do you know that the research shows only 5% has gone to education? Now, why is that so? I challenge the central government. 9,000 crores against your 5,500 crores, which all of it, 80% goes into advertising. For one man, for one prime minister. So when you give your schemes to the states, which state is already doing, we introduced the health scheme, insurance scheme, much before the center. And some people are saying that they have copied our scheme. Today we are providing 100% health from health insurance for every citizen of Bengal without taking one paisa from the center. And it's the same 5 lakh rupees which you get compensated. You've got a card now, which is a cashless card and completely digital. We don't need that central scheme. Same for the Kisan. We have got 6,000 rupees we are giving to the farmers. Now, ultimately, Mamata Banerjee, after Prime Minister talked to her, she said, okay, I will take the Kisan one. To this day, there's been no movement. And had we taken it from the beginning, God knows what would have happened. So there is a propaganda element in this. Where you will not believe the insurance given originally by the center, those who are receiving it were getting a picture of Mr. Modi in the receipt.
Now
this is absolutely, you know, ridiculous. The whole propaganda machinery is the singular focus, not the scheme. And I've given you a live example of Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao. It's a farce.
But Dr. Mitra, if you look at this, right? Your farmers, you say you have a better scheme than what the center is doing. The center didn't say replace that scheme. It said here's an additional 6,000 rupees that your farmers can get. How does it matter, you know, whether it's named PM Kisan or whatever you all call it?
It doesn't matter.
Right? So why don't you all accept that rather
Raj,
than...
We have accepted the farmers one that you're saying. This day we've got nothing. But we are persisting in what the scheme we have given. They are very happy with it. As far as health insurance is concerned, ours is older. Ours has a digitized card. It is cashless and exactly the same scheme, better in quality and better in digitization.
Okay.
So this is a myth that is being propagated. May I go to my second example one second on populism, please? You see, I'll go to the second kind of program we can call populist, which is giving bicycles to the... Oh, you're distributing bicycles, populist. Now, Anima Karak from Jhadgram, which as you know is in Jungle Mahal, she could not go to school because her high school shifted. Her high school was about 7 kilometers from her house. So once she finished the lower school, she couldn't go to the high school. Now she has a bicycle. And do you know how many bicycles? 80 lakh bicycles have been distributed. Result is what? I must give you the result. What is the impact of this? You can ask me. School dropout rate in West Bengal was 3.3 before these projects came. Now it has fallen to 1.5%. And what happened to India? School dropout rate all India was 4%. It has gone up to 5.5%. How did the school dropout rate fall from 3.3 to 1.5? I want to know. Because of the Kanyashri scheme, which requires you to remain in the educational stream, then you only get the 25,000 rupees at the age of 18. Because of the bicycle scheme, where girls in particular are able to reach the schools which they could never do, even boys also. So my question to you is, if the result, by the way, UNESCO, did the baseline study for us, and they've come back saying United Nations gave the highest award to the state of West Bengal in The Hague. Out of 62 countries competing, 520 projects, Karnashi got number one, and Mamata Banerjee received the award on behalf of the people of West Bengal in The Hague.
Okay.
In Netherlands.
Fair enough. Congratulations for that. But let's look at the growth question that we talked about. And yes. The Home Minister, Amit Shah, recently said, when comparing Bengal's growth to the rest of the country, he said Bengal at one time led the country at independence in terms of industrial growth, as well as economic growth. But three decades of communist rule, two decades of TMC, has seen Bengal's growth rate and its position in the country plunge considerably. And he gives for instance, he says that Bengal's position right now is 20th out of the 32 states and union territories, that the FDI is negligible, and yet in your budget speech, and I'm saying this, not Mr. Shah, you said that Bengal has become the new destination for the industry, this I'm quoting you, commerce, manufacturing and communication, that Bengal is becoming the destination in the world map. Now, here are two contradictory views. How do you stand by the fact that Bengal's overall growth as compared to the rest of the country certainly doesn't match up and has dropped considerably in the last 60 years?
I think first point I made to you about the GDP, which I'm sure Honorable Chief Minister, when she comes on, she'll talk more about it. As far as industry is concerned, I'll give you a physical example people can take away. When we came to office, following that, Bengal has become the cement hub of India. Who all have invested that? Mr. Shah know that? Today, you know, Sajjan Jindal has invested. You have Puneet Dalmia has invested. And one by one, and Star Cement has invested. Now, the minute about six big investments came in cement, you know who came here? The German company called BASF. You know what were they making? Invested in Bengal. You're talking about foreign direct investment. You know what they're making? Construction chemicals. Why? Because Bengal has become a cement center. Are you aware that Bengal exports 13% of India's steel and iron? That is nothing. That was not there before in this format. I'm not talking about public sector. And I'm not talking about Durgapur. Primarily 13%. Now, let me go to the next question of investment. TCS, Tata Consulting Service, is today employing 44,000 people in Kolkata. I repeat, 44,000 people. They have just taken land for investing, 20 acres, where they will invest another 15,000. You know what that will mean? TCS will be larger in Kolkata than Bengaluru. They're already close to Bengaluru. With the additional 15,000, they'll be larger. Nobody wants to talk about it. Do you know why? Attrition rate in Kolkata is 3%. It is 35% in Bengaluru and Hyderabad. Because Bengal's boys and girls do not take your human capital and walk away. Nobody talks about that. Already there's expansion in Wipro. And they have taken a piece of land and another 500 crore investment in the Silicon Valley hub. Are you aware that Jio is making a big investment in Bengal, creating the most modern center for IT, which advanced IT, which will be artificial intelligence included, with a joint venture they don't want to reveal with whom, because that's a corporate secret. They've taken 40 acres of land, building a fabulous center. Now, why don't people talk about this? Cognizant. Do you know that Cognizant, the American company, is employing 80,000 people in Kolkata? Now, you're talking about leather, MSME. In one single leather hub, today there are 2,20,000 people working. Do you know it is Asia's largest leather hub? It has 8 CETPs, which cleans the environment. Nowhere else in Asia you have it, not even in China. Now, we are going to 5 lakh people in that leather hub in employment with 80,000 crores investment. So I'm giving you big, I'm giving you small, I'm giving you IT, I'm giving you manufacturing.
But can I just come in We had Governor of West Bengal, Mr. Dhankar, talk to us this morning. And one of the issues he raised was that this government apparently keeps announcing various schemes in the budget, but doesn't implement them. And he gave several examples of that.
This is complete nonsense. This is complete nonsense.
And let me just finish what he said. He said that he has asked the West Bengal government for a report on the various investment summits that they have, that this government has held in the past couple of years, but he has got no report from it, from your.
He has got a report. If he has said that, he is absolutely wrong, and he is saying something that is falsehood. I have personally responded to it.
And what does the report show? He says that there's not much happening.
Well, the report shows that approximately 40% of the investment offers in Bengal Global Business Summits are in process. I have given you a full detail. So this is, I can't understand. I have personally responded to the Honorable Governor. Why doesn't he produce that letter before the public? 40% is in process, and within 3 years to have 40% in process, you have to be very implementation oriented.
He said,
so this is complete falsehood.
Well, he, I think, also mentioned that Tajpur deep sea port in East Midnapore, the expression of interest has been going on for the last 2 years. There's been no progress. Implementation is slow. His larger point is that you'll make big announcement, but when it comes to actual implementation, it's pretty low.
Well, I think if the Honorable Governor is unaware of the fact that the Tajpur port was to be built by the central government with the state of West Bengal, does he know that? Mr. Gadkari came and announced in Bengal Global Business Summit 20,000 crores investment. Then what happened? Then he asked that they want to keep 74%, we keep 26% equity. I agreed to it after talking to the Chief Minister. Nothing happened. Nothing happened. So who's not implementing? You make an announcement in public, you agree to a 74-26, you don't do it, because then what happened is he lost the ministry from shipping, and after that everything got silent. So what we decided is, we will do the Tajpur port ourselves, and you'll be happy to know, and you should inform him, that the expression of interest for competitive bidding is in the market today. And 16 companies have taken the paper, six of which are giants in the world. He doesn't know that. Or he doesn't care to know, or doesn't want to say so. So Tajpur port at 15 meters depth will be able to take Panama-sized vessels, which is 100,000 tons vessels. And the DPR has been done by the two most professional organizations in the country. Therefore, Tajpur port is on. It will bring 15,000 crores investment. It will bring 25,000 crores jobs. So basically, what he's saying, I'd be happy to provide him all this data. Yeah. I have written to him on the BGBS. Why doesn't he show that letter to the public? He's a good friend. I know him for many years. Just simply make that letter public.
Right.
What I have written to him.
Well, he also, one of the things to encourage businesses we've been talking about has become like a slogan, ease of doing business. But Governor Dhankar says that what operates in West Bengal is a syndicate, Raj. That even for truckloads of coals, a certain amount of hafta has to be paid. That wherever you go down, even for construction, there is a certain price to be paid, a party cut that's there. How true are these allegations that he's making?
I think he can make any allegations. I am not here to have the tone and tenor of accusation and counter-accusation. I am here to give you the facts.
And what are the facts?
Ease of doing business, as per World Bank's 374 parameters, West Bengal was number one 2 years ago. I'll give you an example. Government of India gave us an award on e-taxation 4 years ago. Isn't that ease of doing business? Recently, Government of India has given us an award on e-afghari, which is excise. And you know, corruption in excise is all over the world. They have given us the highest award in the country called e-afghari award. Why did they do that? So I can give you 20 examples where we are number one in the country today, where Government of India is giving us awards. We have got 4 major awards from the Government of India, 6 major awards from other major institutions in the world. Please ask him. United Nations gives an award to West Bengal in competition with the whole world.
So tell us something about, Dr. Mitra, apart from the awards, which we applaud you, what is the kind of ease that you're doing business with here? Is there special single windows?
What you,
yeah.
I'll tell you, they basically we have identified where ease of business is a problem. And each one we have tackled systematically. For example, when you do a registration of a property, do you know that in West Bengal it is digitally muted automatically? Which state can show you that? That the entire documentation of ownership of land is now digital. And when you register something, mutation happens automatically back to back. I want to know which state has been able to do that. And states are coming to West Bengal to learn as to how we are able to do this. Integrated financial management system. I want whoever is accusing, want him to know, not one rupee in West Bengal goes out of the treasury in cash or even in check. Can you believe? It's entirely digital. And who has recognized that? Government of India, Modi government, giving us an award for integrated financial management system. Three states are sitting right today in Kolkata, working with my colleagues to understand how the integrated financial management system has been put up, what's the software used, what's the methodology, what's the technology. Can anyone, I don't want to speak of the governor, can anyone deny this? Go and ask the Modi government, why did you give them an award? Why did you give them an award of e-taxation as ease of doing business? Why e-abgari? So what is fascinating to me is we are getting tracked out into accusation and counter-accusation. Well, I am just giving you the bare-bone facts.
Okay, let's get to an issue that when we are talking about growth, one of the key issues is debt and the amount of debt that West Bengal is facing. Last time counted, it was 33% of its GSDP, much higher than the 20% of GSDP that the FRBM prescribes. What are you doing about debt?
FRBM prescribes no debt.
Well, a review committee recently recommended that. Let's be
no.
Accurate.
I'm sorry. I completely disagree. There is no such thing. FRBM is the proportion of GDP that you can borrow, and that was 3% before the COVID. You'd be happy to know West
that
Bengal kept
yes.
well below 3% every day, every year. Now, yes. When we came to office, the debt GDP ratio, as you know, Raj, you don't talk about debt. Because Nagaland's debt and Maharashtra's debt are not comparable. You have to have a denominator. What is a denominator? GDP. So debt GDP ratio, that's what you and I as economists call, not debt. Now, when we came to office, debt GDP ratio was 44%. Approximately in that range. Do you know that this has come down to 34%? Because GDP was 4.5 lakh crores when we came to office. According to CSO, Central Statistical Organization's accepted figure, GDP is 12.5 lakh crores today. Since GDP has ballooned in size according to central government's own statistic, naturally our capacity to service debt has gone down. By the way, what is the debt GDP ratio of Government of India today? Please tell me. It's about 80%. In that some range in that. What is United States debt GDP ratio? It's 106%. West Bengal's debt GDP ratio today is 34%, way below what we came when we came to this office, when 37 years of misrule by the communists took place. They kept on borrowing and there was no GDP. So that debt GDP ratio has skyrocketed. So my answer to anybody who says that is don't talk about debt. No economist ever talks about debt. They talk about debt GDP ratio as a ratio to something. And that has come down. Fiscal deficit. Do you know in the middle of COVID, I just announced in the budget 2.9% fiscal deficit. 2.9. What is the center trying to do? Struggling with 9%. So my question is, you look at the discipline of the fiscal structure. I think we have already got awards on it. We'll get another award on the fiscal discipline of the state.
We are running out of time, but I've got a question for you on disinvestment. We have seen that the central government in the recent budget has made an outline of disinvestment of its major public sector enterprises, given a roadmap down what all it'd like to divest with and what all it would like to keep. Has the state done a similar exercise? Because the biggest thing is also, again, state enterprises eating into your funds, and particularly loss-making state units.
I think there are two things I'd like to very, I know time is running out. One is disinvestment. Let me tell you, you want to disinvest LIC. Life Insurance Corporation, do you know, has 250 million people who have Life Insurance Corporation. Do you know that Life Insurance Corporation had a income growth of 9.5%? Here, I want to give you a sense. I was on the board of SAIL and GAIL boards. Big problem that Mr. Modi government does not understand, because it doesn't understand macroeconomics, it doesn't understand many other things. They are not interested in understanding. They are more interested in dividing society in majoritarian structure and win elections. So they don't understand. What is the reason? SAIL and GAIL, the joint secretary, additional secretaries of ministries, they run the public sector. In one occasion, I said SAIL should buy a coking coal mine in Australia. I must tell you, later to be chairman of the election commission, Dr. Qureshi, additional secretary from the ministry, said, please listen to the independent director. For once, the government guy said, listen, so everybody followed. So please understand, give them autonomy. They are marvelous institutions. I've been 5 and 5 years in both. In the case of GAIL, I saw the same thing. They were going to do city gas in China. Do you know the consultant hired was to be paid 50 lakhs? I said, no, you must know Mandarin. Otherwise, the Chinese will, take you off the table with their, because they have characters, not words. Finally, they agreed because the government fellow agreed. And 8 crores were saved with the city gas in China produced by GAIL. So fundamental question that Modi government does not understand. Give autonomy to these people, they will flower. In terms of banks, private banks today, best bank is HDFC. What is the foreign holding in that? 73%. ICICI, it's not a, by the way, officially it's not an Indian bank. ICICI, 67% foreign holding. Okay, that's a model for private people. What happened to Yes Bank? When it collapsed, State Bank of India has put in 9,000 crores into Yes Bank. So you want to privatize banks. When a private bank has failed, you take from government bank and you put in 9,000 crores. So do you want, is this a model? Let there be a discussion in the country. Let the data come onto the table about public sector. I've been on the boards of 2 public sector units. Give them autonomy, not run it by the ministry. And you will see they will flower.
So you don't agree with the current government's policy that it is outlined in the budget?
The government's current policy is totally unresearched. I'm giving you the data. First, you start by giving autonomy to the public sectors and see how they perform. Have discussion in the country. Banks' NPAs are shooting up. You are shooting the banks. 20,000 crores of capitalization. Raj, you and I know 1.3 lakh crores is needed for capitalization. So squeeze the banks and then privatize them.
Dr. Mitra, you know, you're on the same
place. Let me say, after privatization, they become taken over by global financial institutions, as it is the case with private banks today.
This is a model. This is what, when I was speaking recently to the Swadeshi Jagran Manch convener, this is what he likes. I mean, you're on the same page with him on this.
Then I don't RSS, know what Swadeshi Jagran Manch is an RSS organization. Bhartiya Mazdoor Sangh is an RSS organization, but keeping quiet today. The worst labor laws have been initiated in India. They're keeping quiet. Bhartiya Kisan Sangh is an RSS affiliated organization. Do you hear its name now with the Kisan movement all over the country? So I'm not sure, what front organizations of 300 front organizations, who's saying what, that's their business, that is their prerogative. All I'm saying is, let us study it. I'm not saying just simply throw away everything. I'm saying you have family silver. Have you given them autonomy? I am telling you, as an independent director for 10 years in 2 largest public sector companies, there was no autonomy. The ministry ran them, even with the eyes, the chairman will look at the eyes of the additional secretary and joint secretary, see whether they are approving of what we are discussing. Give them real autonomy. Then do an analysis.
You made your point. We are running out of time, Dr. Mitra. Just a final question for you. You've handled the finances for 10 years. What would you do if you came back to power? What is the big thing you would do?
I think that will come out very soon in our manifesto, to be announced by, which is every party does so. Mamata Banerjee would be the one who will answer your question, I think, in the evening. Let me add, one thing we discussed earlier, we talk about is federalism. I'll just put two words on that. I want to say, central government is squeezing out the heart of the economy, which is the federal finances of the states, not my party state, BJP state, Congress state. First, GST compensation, you take it to a point where the trust is lost. Federalism is destroyed. Cutting central schemes in the name of reorganization. Increasing state sharing in state sponsorship schemes. So if I'm paying 50%, government is paying 50%, if I'm 50%, raise it to 70%, squeeze. Cutting off devolution. Do you know that last year the central government denied West Bengal 11,000 crores of devolution? It's a constitutional right. They collect taxes from us and give us 42% back. They never gave us 11,000 crores. Increasing cess and surcharge. Modi government has gone from 8% to 16% of their revenue, cess and surcharge. Why? They don't have to share cess and surcharge by the state. So I'm just closing with this thought. This is a federalist polity of India. Systematically, the federalist polity is being destroyed. Piece by piece. When the union finance minister says, COVID is being fought by the states on the ground. She said this on record. In that case, why don't you give resources? Do you know how much they have given? We have spent 4,000 crores on COVID. Center has given 279 crores. It's a shame. So you cut off the state's finances, put them in the dock, and then you talk about federalism and cooperative federalism. I'm very concerned that this is not the India that we know.
Well, this is a good way to end the session. Thank you so much, Dr. Mitra. We have, following you, Mr. Vivek Debroy is here, and he probably can answer some of the questions on behalf of the center. Till then, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.